Good morning, everyone. This is Dr. Preeti Gupta from the Ramaya College of Arts, Science and Commerce Department of English. Today, I'm going to take up the lesson Definitions of Femininity and Masculinity, written by Sujata Sen, which is a part of your general English course book. So, as the title itself suggests, we might take up some ways how femininity and masculinity, the terms, have come into existence, and how these terms have been constructed by certain factors. So this essay, which Sujata Sen has written, is actually a part, an extract from her book, Gender Studies. So when she talks about gender studies, she talks about how these concepts have been created by people in society and the various institutions that exist in our society around us. To begin with, let me quote Friedrich Nietzsche. "The same passions in man and woman nonetheless differ in tempo. Hence, man and woman do not cease misunderstanding one another." The quote is very true. A man and a woman carrying similar passions are always different in their approach towards life, towards the things they understand. And that is one reason why they tend to always misunderstand each other. Another question I would like to raise in the beginning is, is there a demand to adhere to the rigid social structures, societal structures of masculine and feminine traits? Is it? I don't think so. There is any need to do so. Because when we do so, we are eradicating, we are overcoming, we are over-empowering the basic differences of being a male and a female. So the rigid patriarchal structures, the patriarchal society has created rigid societal structures which are adhered to being a masculine and being a feminine. For example, I'll give you, a man is called strong, robust, intelligent, as you see in the picture there, lifeguard. Vis-a-vis a woman who is called as beautiful, who's called as not as intelligent as a man, and she is always physically dependent upon the boy, and she is not very as strong as a boy also. So all these features and traits are adhered to by the people, but where it came from? So probably there is a whole range of reasons that might exist for all this. So we will discuss all that in this lesson today. Let me begin mentioning about the author. Sujata Sen is a professor at the Department of Sociology, University of Kalyani, West Bengal. She has been teaching the subject for more than 2 decades. So you can well imagine how good her hold has been on the subject feminism. Second, she has contributed essays on gender, sociological theory in several national journals and edited volumes. Third, the prescribed essay which is taking up, which we are doing today, is apart from your gender studies book, I've already told you. Fourth, the essay helps, what will be the outcome? The essay will help you to understand the various social processes which are enforced by the diverse social institutions around you to strengthen gendered definitions of femininity and masculinity. So this is what we are going to do with this lesson here today. Okay, let me first explain what is femininity and what is masculinity according to Sujata Sen given here. Femininity implies that it is natural that a woman is delicate and attractive physically, sensitive psychologically, and intellectually inferior to men. Nurturing the family is a duty and should be her priority. So many people might not agree to this. They would say, why nurturing the family is a duty and her priority? But yes, that is one feminine trait which is attached to all the females existing in this world probably. So that is why we are going to see how these constructs get built up. Then coming to masculinity, on the contrary, a man should not cry, which is very common. You have seen, if a boy starts crying, you will say, oh, you are a girl, you're behaving like a girl. So all these immediately comes as a response from the society because you have already attached those masculine traits to that boy. The boy should not help or work in the kitchen, unlike his mother or sister. He should be dashing, ambitious, successful, and experimenting with life itself. So you can see that how the traits attached to femininity and masculinity is what you see around yourself in society. And such discriminations against women. You can see man is projected all positive. So such discriminations against women depend on the constructions of femininity and masculinity that have prevailed over ages. Let's look at some constructions that increase the differences between men and women now. So these will be the processes which I was talking about. I hope you're clear with the definitions of masculinity and femininity. So one more thing I would like to tell you before proceeding. Masculinity and femininity would definitely be purely be taken as a social construct, the words. Whereas the biological word would be male and female. So there are no traits, no such traits of what we read at the back slide here. There are no such traits attached to male and female. Because male and female are the terms which are biological and are free from all these kinds of constructions. What society has done is attaching these traits and calling them masculinity and femininity thereafter. So I hope you are very, very clear that how these traits give them these terminologies. So let's proceed towards the process. So looking at the various processes that enforce the gender constructs. First, family. That is the basis. That is where your life begins. As it is always told, that home is the first learning center for any child in the universe. So there is that is the place where you first start with your conditioning, the so-called conditioning, what you have to behave like. Family is the first reason. Second is media. Media is also very much responsible for enhancing such constructs. Third, social stratification. I'll come to this in detail again. Religion, very important. Education, very, very important indeed. Because the way a person is educated helps molding his mindset. Coming to work culture and then sex and gender. So I will be taking them all of them one by one here. First one, family. Okay. In earlier times, I'm picking up the pointers here for your reference as it is mentioned in the essay by Sujata Sen. So in the earlier times, women were homemakers only and they used to take care of the house, children and not at all working. She had no social right and liberty and no free will. So, and most of you are aware also, if you talk to your grannies, if you talk to your parents who have been belonging to those earlier times, you would have seen that those mothers and those grandmothers and those great grandmothers have always been homemakers. And homemakers, not only homemakers, it's not wrong to be a homemaker. The point is, along with being a homemaker, they have always been subservient to the male members of the family. That is, they had no social right and liberty. They never had the right to take decisions. They never had the right to socially intermingle with other people, whomsoever they like, their friends, anybody around. They would take, consciously or unconsciously, they would take the advice or they would take the consent of their male members of the family. So they never had any free will to do whatever they wanted to do. They were always domesticated. That is what we call domesticated. So earlier times, women were domesticated. They never had any free will. They never had any choice to work. But, okay, let's take today's scenario. In today's changing times, still there is a continuation of gender stereotypes. Though people are working, women are working, they are economically independent, yet they are not free as a homemaker. What does it imply? That though the women today are far more free than the earlier times, they are ready to work, they are working out, they have stepped out into the working scenario today, but still the constructions of being a feminine is still going on. Still there is a continuation of gender stereotypes. How now? I hope you all are aware of the term stereotype. Stereotype are some typical features which are attached to a particular term or a particular person. For example, gender stereotypes here means what are the specific words which are attached to a particular gender, which you have already read in the first page itself. That is talking about masculinity and femininity. Those are gender stereotypes. Okay, so now I was talking about that how there is a continuation of these gender stereotypes. Let's see. Okay. Let's see some examples here which I have written. First is pink for girls, blue for boys. Very common. And you all are following it also. I hardly see. There is a change. Definitely, I don't say 100% everything is existing. There is a change. But girls always prefer pink. Boys always prefer blue shades. Why? Because these are some kinds of gender stereotypes only. And you see that there is a continuation of these stereotypes even in today's times when things are changing. So such stereotypes helps building up the constructs of femininity and masculinity. Second, reasons. These are all the reasons how the differences are built up. Okay, second, books have always shown that women are weak and fragile and men are strong and protector. Do you agree? Yes, I hope so. Because if you go for any kind of books, if you read books, I don't know how many of you do so. If you read books, you will see that in the books also, women are always projected as very weak, feminine, fragile, beautiful, delicate, needs protection from the boys, whereas men are not shown to be so. So this is also one kind of gender stereotype which is being constructed unconsciously or consciously. Third, toys which are given to the children at the time of their birth itself, since the birth itself, a newborn baby is there and all the family members, all the friends have gathered around with all the beautiful gifts and toys for the baby. What do they get? For the boy, they will bring a heroic image of a Batman or a Spider-Man or a Superman or a gun or a car or a bat ball. Why? Why they will not think getting a beautiful doll for the boy? Because these are the type, this is again a gender stereotype continuation where the toys also decide the gender. So the toys which are given to the boys are different and the toys which are given to the girls are different. For the girls, it will be only Barbies, it will be only delicate, beautiful stuff which will be right for them, considered right for them. So now what is happening here? When you are getting the toys to the child who is a newborn, a newborn does not have any idea that what is gender. A newborn doesn't have any idea that I have to behave like a boy or behave like a girl. I have to behave masculine or feminine. But when you hand over a particular toy to the boy, he automatically starts adhering himself to the masculine traits. And when you start giving the feminine toys to the newborn baby girls, they start adhering themselves to those feminine traits. So this is how gender stereotypes are getting built up. Now, third, the next one, talking about the newborn girl babies, which are often called as cute, tiny, soft and delicate, whereas the boys are seen as strong and hardy. So newborn baby is there in front of you and you will compliment the girl as so cute, so pretty. But for the boy, smart young man. So such kind of words when it comes from you as complimenting a new baby, that itself is building up a gender stereotype. So in this whole process, what I have discussed with you, giving you so many examples here, we see that in the process of growing up, when you're growing up right from your birth, right from your childhood, children learn gender stereotyped characteristics. So this is called gender stereotypes. And the last point here, just refer to that. The third one, the process by which a child learns the differences based on gender is called gender socialization. Kindly note the term gender socialization. This is the process by which you learn it. So this is what was there about family. Coming to next factor, which is responsible for building up this difference between femininity and masculinity, is media. Okay, how media? First, press, television, radio, films, and the advertising. This is what we see on all media. all are controlled by the economic and constitutes the definitions of women's selves in a way that suits the status quo. What does it imply? It says that all these media forms are controlled by the economic powers. And who are having those economic powers? That's the patriarchy. And they are making, constituting the definitions of women's selves, what a woman should be like, in a way that suits the status quo. That suits the status quo means that suits their status quo. How they would like to maintain their status, they make their definitions according to that. So media turns out to be a big reason why the women's image gets built up. Second point says, represent women in a very patriarchal mode. So patriarchal mode, I've discussed it already, that how women are being shown from the eyes of a patriarchy. It gives woman a body image that is highly desirable. So woman is seen as an object of desire rather than as a equal human being. Third, slim actresses, slimmer models are depicted that may lead to anorexia, bulimia and depression amongst young girls who desire the same. So this is one very important factor. In fact, what happens is, in the movies, in the media forms, all the media forms, you see that the image of a beautiful girl is a slimmer person. And in order to reach that state, many a times the girls, the young girls, the adolescents who desires to reach that stage is suffering from many problems like anorexia, bulimia and depression. Why? Because they cannot reach so, and ultimately they turn depressive. So who has given that idea to them? The media. Their parents never told them that you do not look good and you do not look beautiful and you need to reach that stage in order to be presentable. So this is how media is responsible for all those problems. Next, influence the minds right from teenage. So media is a very important factor. Why from teenage? In fact, I would like to say right from childhood itself. Look at the number of children who are using mobile phones, smartphones, tabs and all those things. Why? Because they have such a huge access to media and media forms that the influence begins right at the childhood itself. The example given here with Sujata Sen is in the text, the M&B romances have creates upon its reader escapist fantasies, miles away from realities. Give the women defined roles as a male dependent and a family oriented entity. So when you read Mills and Boons, you all have read, so I'm very, very sure. And when you read them, you go into a fantasized world. You go into a world of imagination, miles away from reality, where woman is given those roles, where she is dependent upon the man and she is only oriented to the family and she is subservient and she is beautiful and she is again an object of desire. So these roles are created from media forms, and definitely it further differentiates between a masculinity and femininity, which is not required. We need to stick ourselves to, as I told you in the beginning, the biological terms called male and female who are equal. There was no need to construct or adhere to such traits, but we are doing so. So media is highly responsible for that. So some more points about from media. Independent, intellectual, successful woman of today is rarely shown in media. You all agree? It is there, it exists, but it is not so clearly depicted by media because they are always running down the risk of being overtaken by them. As it is a patriarchal world, and if shown, it is again overshadowed. Overshadowed by what? Patriarchal ideology. Second, media influences definitions of masculinity. So as I discussed all these points, you can well imagine now that how media has influenced the definitions of masculinity. Telling that man is superior, man is strong, man is the only breadwinner of the family, or man is the only person dependent whom we are to be dependent. Third, a typical hero image is created from the ideology of masculinity, and that is dominant, forceful, and at times even brutal. Fourth, women are shown as caring and nurturing by media. And fifth, through its easy identification processes, personal identities gets created among men and women. What is easy identification process? See, easy identification is nothing but when we are watching something, we easily identify those things to ourselves. Or we are, the as it is always told, the visual impact is more than anything else. So this is nothing but a visual impact. And when we see anything visually, we get affected by it more than anything else and create personal identities that I am like that, or I need to be like that. Or if a woman is being shown on the media in a particular way with particular traits, I need to be like her or I am like her. So these personal identities gets created among men and women. So media is highly responsible. Third is social stratification. Social stratification is nothing but the process where you divide people in classes. Social classes are stratified and accentuated. Accentuated means further increased. Second, femininity, according to such representation, is for male entertainment and possession. So, this is how woman is again under subservient position. Third, women are considered to be male property and pushed into domestic roles and family-oriented lives and selfhoods. See, there are situations where it is overpowered by men to such an extent that they are not given any right to their own bodies also. Fourth, poor lower class women have to fight discrimination at two levels, not only from the males within the family, but also from the both the males and females from other classes. That means what? A poor woman is belonging to a social strata of lower class. When there she has to suffer at the hands of the man in her own class, whereas the hands of man and woman above her class, that is the upper class. So a poor lower class woman is considered to be in the lowest form of social stratification, where she has to suffer a lot. The fourth reason which helps in building up these differences and creates problems is religion. Religion shows that all religious scriptures and texts assign particular roles to each gender. You must have read any one of the religious scripture, definitely. And there you must have seen that women are shown as wives and daughters, dutiful wives and daughters, basically homemakers, supportive and submissive, and are the thread that holds the family together. So a woman who is not being a wife, a nice wife and a daughter, will definitely not be able to hold the family together, is written in the religious scriptures, and that is why they adhere to all that. Second, men are the breadwinners, the religion tells them, who have to look after the material aspects of family and fulfill family needs. So that is why women always try to look up to men for all their needs in order to fulfill the family needs and in order to have a better life. Who told them to do this? Religion. They have guided them. Third, God is usually a man. That is very important. God is usually a man. Why God is never taken as she? So God is usually a man, and the agents of his wisdom are more often men only. So when he talks about the wisdom factor, that will be associated only to men again. Women mostly are passive carriers of this divine wisdom. So where you have seen in temples and mosques and churches, only men are usually dictating the religious connotations and not women. They are only the passive carriers. Passive means they are not at all actively involved in delivering it. They're just passively accepting it. So religion is also responsible to a large extent. Okay, religion is responsible, but feminists argue. What are the arguments in context with religion that the feminist says? The feminist says that a gendered religion, what we have just seen in the previous slide, a gendered religion has oppressed women. Very true, probably. Second, it is maintained within religious texts that a woman is impure and temptress, which is wrong. So this we can see how it is in application seen in certain temples also, where women are not allowed to step in and worship the god. And the famous one, you have seen the Sabrimala temple, which was much in controversy regarding women entering the temple and appreciating God or worshipping God. So that is there. Third one, that religion makes women possessions to be given away in marriage. So the religion makes women to a possession which is to be given away just in marriage. That is, it is moving from one house to the other wherein she does not have an identity of her own. Then religion, it is argued, makes a woman a male possession. So these are the points which are just creating
a bad image for a woman.
The fifth factor is education. Stereotypes concerning gender differences in terms of intellectual abilities and educational patterns observed by males and females. So education is also mentioning how the stereotypes, through education also the stereotypes are created, which is creating differences between males and females and making them masculine and feminine. First point, believed that the girls and the women are not good at maths or science. Sometimes it is shown education is responsible, definitely, maths or science, but are excellent at languages, social sciences and arts. So interior designing, why women doesn't, men doesn't adopt that course? Why only women will go for interior designing? Because they are considered to be best at social sciences and art, and man to be a master of technology. So these are the things which has come from education. Then second, reading, art and music is seen as feminine subjects, and mathematics, athletics and mechanical skills as masculine. So even today you will see that the sports would be much taken up by men than women. Why? Women might have that skill, might have that strength also, but yet they don't take up because they might be conditioned, because their mindset is so now. They are not even ready to do it because they feel that they are weaker. Then third, girls are hardworking and sincere but never brilliant. This is also one famous belief by people, which is right or wrong, people have to rejudge it. So such gender generalizations, those were gendered stereotypes. These are similarly stereotypes only, gender generalizations that make it difficult for the genius of a girl to grow, and this should not happen. So the feminists are wanting all these things to be highlighted. Feminists here like Sujata said, she's highlighting this in order to ensure such things should not continue in future. Next is culture. Culture, your culture is also one very important reason why the gender constructs are created. So Sujata Sen here argues in this essay that recent decades have seen an influx of women into the labor market. Okay, so there is a lot of increase in the labor market, a lot of women participants, increase in the participation of women in organized sector also, it is there. Educational and other infrastructural facilities for women have opened up. A number of avenues for their work and employment outside the home is existing. Despite all the above mentioned three reasons, there is an increase in the number of women in managerial cadres also. Despite above the three reasons, what I mean to say is there is the increase in the number of women in the managerial cadres has been limited, pointing out to the unequal representation of women in the corporate world. So in the corporate world, I feel that what Sujata Sen is arguing here is quite right to some extent, but definitely in the corporate world, there's a lot of increase in the women at managerial positions, and they are changing the situations now, making people understand that they're very good at their work. The last point here on the slide is, due to gender differences, it's difficult for women to break through the glass ceiling. So this is the glass ceiling where they cannot sometimes break through and they cannot enter the other side. But though efforts have been taken up by feminists in order to help women break the ceiling and move to the other side. So due to these differences, it's difficult for women to break the glass ceiling of higher promotions and vertical movement. Vertical movement, that they are not able to move vertically in the hierarchy. They are not able to grow in the corporate segment, or they are not able to grow into the organization vertically, reaching a higher position because of the culture which is created around them. Next talks about sex and gender. So those were the factors which were responsible, which we have discussed. Towards the end of the essay, Sujata Sen points out that feminism points out to major differences between sex and gender. Simone de Beauvoir maintained, she is a very famous feminist writer, Simone de Beauvoir, she maintained that we must remember in this context that women are not born, they are made. Very, very right. I loved the quote when I read it. We must remember that women are not born. They are born as females. We have made them one. We have made them woman. We have made them feminine, we have conditioned them, we have changed their psychology to our own advantage, and we have told them that you are like this, this and this. Your traits are so and so. So they were not born with those traits. It is a patriarchal society which has allotted those traits to women. So gender, definitions of sex and gender here. Gender refers to the practices that the society, the culture and the ideologies propagate because of sexual differences. Right from birth via growth, individuals get a gendered personality. All which I have discussed with you previously. They get a gendered personality when a baby, newborn baby is getting a pink blanket, a beautiful Barbie doll, whereas a newborn baby boy is getting a Superman hero in a miniature, or he is getting a blue color bed. That defines. So these are the things which are responsible for creating the term called gender. So I'll just read it here for you. In third line, individuals get a gendered personality that defines their attitudes and behavior. So this is how gender is a term which is given by society. Then sex. It refers to the biological differences between females and males. Differences that are natural, biological, and consequently unalterable. So this is what I was talking about in the beginning also. We are males and females, and we are made by the gender constructs as masculine and feminine. I hope it is very clear to you now. Okay, reading a little about sex and gender. Gender is a cultural term and refers to the roles that are allotted to women and men by society. Very true, the roles which are given to men and women by society through contrasting stereotypes of femininity and masculinity. So these are the contrasting stereotypes which we have discussed in all the slides, with all the factors responsible for building up this difference. The last, it says, patriarchy make the distinction between sex and gender blur. So many of you might not be knowing the differences between sex and gender. You might have always considered the two terms as similar. But why you have got the two terms as similar? The reason why you have got the two terms as blurred, in no distinction, proper distinction, because of patriarchal setup. They want to mix the two terms and presume that all the distinctions between men and women are based on biological or anatomical differences. For example, I'll give you here. Women may be mothers. They are giving birth to a child. Very true. Biologically, they can give birth to a child, but they need not be made responsible for nurturing, educating, and raising a child, or devoting their whole life and time to building up the home and the family. Why only women? These roles are socially and culturally assigned to women. God did not tell them that if you give birth to a child, you have to bring up the child also, or you have to manage the family also. No, these roles are given to women by society and culture, and are definitely not biological in nature. So this is a beautiful example telling that how things are imposed upon women, which was never analyzed earlier. Here goes the conclusion for all of you. First, feminists believe that biological differences between men and women are minor and do not justify the gender differences. So a male and a female are so because of their biological differences, and those minor biological differences of man having a little more physical strength than woman can be true, but that does not justify, or that does not give you the right to create any gender differences among them. It is wrong. If you do so, you are enhancing many other problems of society. And second, feminism thus strives to achieve a gendered personhood. So this is what feminism is wanting to achieve. Feminism thus strives to achieve a genderless personhood. Everybody should be equal. Man and woman should not be considered as different. They should be different, but only biologically, as being a male and a female. So thank you so much for listening to me. I hope the session was useful to you. And if you have any doubts, you're most welcome, students, to please post up the questions and the queries. And I would definitely love to answer your doubts. Thank you so much.